Okay, so thank you for coming to the session. My name is Marianne Fink. I come from SimCorp. It's a Danish company. And I've really been looking forward to talking here today. And this is going to be sharing a story, our story from our agile transformation. And I hope that the story will resonate with you. Already today, I've heard a lot of things that I can recognize from what we've been doing, things that I have been also wondering how are other people doing, and I hope that when I share what we've been doing, you will think the same way. Maybe you will ask some questions, or you will feel reassured that, wow, they did something similar to us and they had the same experiences. So that the same way that all good stories bring something good to you. So before I get started, SimCorp is a software company. We have one product. And in our development division, we're about 500 people. And the agile transformation, or the agile journey that I'm going to talk about, is a journey for these 500 people. I work as a change manager in the product division, and I've been working in the team that was involved with the transformation from the beginning. So how many of you are familiar with ADKAR? Okay, so before I talk about ADKAR, I maybe should tell a little bit about the title of my talk. I said eating your own dog food or dog fooding. And this is an expression from software, of course, where companies that develop software use their own products. So this is not about SimCorp using our own product in our agile transformation. This is actually about using the model for change that we decided to use when we started our agile transformation. So 4 years ago, we decided that now was the time to change the way we work in the product division from a traditional waterfall model to ADKAR or agile ways of working. And in that connection, we decided, or we made a proposal to say, in order to be successful with this change, we want to invest in the way we work with change management. So we have a structured approach. We focus on the individual change, so each individual person, how can they go through all the different changes that will come? How can we create good change stories that people can relate to? And how can we create coalitions of sponsors that can help drive the changes forward? So these were some of the key elements that we were discussing and were very much aware of that they were important to be successful with all the agile changes. And this ADKAR model is actually very simple. If you think about any change, a change you want to make in your private life, at work, something you want to drive or something somebody else is pushing to you, you have to go through these five phases in order for the change to be successful. So first you have to be aware of why do I need to change. If you don't understand or have awareness, it doesn't really make sense to move on. After that, you have to have a desire to be part of it. There has to be something in it for you, something where you can see this is going to put me in a better place or this is something that I can learn something from. Sometimes desire can be a little challenging because you sit at work and you think, ah, maybe I don't have that desire for some new thing. But it can also be the decision to go along with the change, if that makes it a little bit more palatable. Then you can start to give knowledge. And that is, for instance, training or information or sharing. And from then you move on to ability. So you have to have systems or a setup that allow you to use your new skills in the way that it was intended. And then finally, you have a reinforcement phase where people, you reinforce the changes to make the change stick. So this was a model, and if you think of any of the agile changes, you can think we introduced Scrum teams. Think about how you could explain this in your organization using these different steps. We did this for almost any change that we introduced to the product division. But what did we do with regards to HR? How did we manage the change that we were trying to make in our product division in our relationship with a key stakeholder as HR? So We did set up a transformation team. We heard about it before also, that you can create a group of people that are the ones that help drive a transformation forward. And we had that with representatives from the product division and also two representatives from HR. But how much did we actually invest in explaining or learning together what is all this agile about? How will it impact HR? How will it impact our HR processes? And looking back now, we can actually say we didn't invest that much time. We didn't use this model towards a key stakeholder such as HR. And so this is one of the things that I want to get to now, because I have 20 minutes to talk now, and it's not a lot. So I want to actually start by telling you something about the key learnings that we had from our journey. And then afterwards, I'll give you some examples of how we learned this. So one of the first key learnings we had was that this whole involving our key stakeholders is very, very important. It's something that we should have done from the beginning, and we didn't do that. The other thing that we learned was that even though you can make a lot of changes moving to Agile without changing the structures of your organization, you can actually also become blocked by that. So it's all, you can always talk about keeping the HR setup or the processes, for instance, performance management, etc., the way that it is. But it can actually block people from changing when they are restricted by the system. So this was another key learning. And then the last key learning that we had was, and I think that was funny before, Alice, she also talked about it, this was this sharing, talking about the changes, talking about the good experiences, making it visible what is happening. And we've had this sort of key saying of sharing is caring, and we've used it over and over in the transformation, and it is really a key learning, this whole thing of not forgetting to share all the good stories. There are a lot of the bad experiences, things that are not working, things that we don't like, that we talk about at the coffee machine. So in order to make people aware and remember all the good things, that just continue to talk about all these changes. And some of them might seem very small and not significant, but actually by keeping on repeating them, you make also the changes stick. So we saw before some examples of what could be changes in an agile transformation that relate to HR. And before I came to this conference, I did some collaboration with representatives from our HR organization and with people from our development organization. And I asked, what do you think are the key milestones? What are the most important things that we have done in the last 4 years, change that relate to HR, that we should put on a roadmap or to show what we've done? And so the ones that came up here are the ones that we have actually worked with and also done changes to. Then I also asked, how would they rank them? So what do they think is most important? And here you can see that changing the organizational structure was at the top, and the second one was changing leadership approach. Then we also had changing performance management, and then some of the others. I won't be able to talk about all of these here, but we've actually worked with all of them, and I will be happy to share some of our experiences later on. So as I now move on, as much time as we have, I will talk to each of them. But let's get to the first one. So in the fall of 2015, that's when we started our Agile transformation. And we created, as I said before, this transformation team that consisted of people from the development organization and representatives from HR. And in the beginning, what we did actually pretty much followed the roadmap from SAFe. So we had decided that we wanted to implement SAFe in the organization. And at the time, this picture didn't exist on the SAFe page. But now, looking back, we can actually go, check, this is what we did. We did a lot of these things also. But we did have one major disruption that was not shown on this roadmap. And that was 6 months into the transformation, we decided to create a whole new organizational structure. So 500 people had to be reorganized. And we decided to use the roles from SAFE and create a very flat organizational structure. At first, this decision can seem very simple. You can say, this is something we want to change, and from December 1st, this is how the new organization is going to look. So in that sense, you can say this, the change happens one day, and the next day, the change is there. But of course, it's not that simple. And even though we had the HR representatives in the group when we made this decision, I don't think any of us realized until we started looking into the things, what was the consequence of this decision? So that meant that suddenly we opened up this Pandora's box of what should the role descriptions be? How should our job ads look? What should the hierarchy be? What is our different other career path systems and compensation levels and all this? So it was easy enough to say these are the roles we're going to have. But then that just led to a lot of other things that we suddenly needed to figure out. And if you think back to the change that we talked about before, even though we were all together in deciding that this was what we wanted to do, we didn't really explore the full extent of the change. And we didn't fully understand exactly what are all the things we now need to figure out together. And in, as I said before, we talk a lot in the organization about creating this sponsorship coalition, people that can come together and talk about why are we doing this and how are we going to be doing that. And this example with the change in the organizational structure is actually a really good example where you could say we had involvement and we discussed it, but we didn't together manage or plan and manage the change up front. And so we learned in the hard way, we did make the change and we did come out on the other end. But you could say, how successful were we with that change? If we had invested more in working together on doing this, could we have implemented something that was maybe better, up and running faster, and not just in the lines in the diagram, right? So this was an interesting, you can say, start and a quick start and a major change for us. And the organization that we made at that time actually is still in place. So you can say in that sense, we haven't changed anything on the look of the change. So let's move on to another one. This is a leadership approach, and you talked about it before also. And the interesting, I took this picture from the poster, and it's because from the beginning of our transformation, we've talked about this, that we wanted to change our leadership style. And this is not a change like the organizational change where you say, this starts tomorrow, and then that change is implemented on paper. This is a process that has been going on for 4 years, and over that period of time, there's been a lot of negotiation and discussion in the organization. What does this really mean? How do we understand all these different concepts? And how can we support these concepts, not just by talking about being catalyst leaders or giving feedback? How can we put in place things that can help us actually behave in this way? So here we have had a lot of focus on what are things we can do, things we can share, that people can understand so that they know what do I have to do, what do I have to go out and do in order to reflect all of this. And I think that from a product division and HR perspective, the nice thing about this collaboration has also been that we have made some changes in the product division that we can now see that HR is now taking to other parts of the organization. So others hear about what is going on in our part of the organization and ask, what is this feedback? How does that work? Can we also implement that in the learnings for managers in other part of the organization or in the way that we work. And I think also another important part here is, of course, that this is one of the things where it's so easy to fall back. We heard that also before, that there are things where when we get stressed or when things are happening around us, it's so easy to forget some of these things. So having the reminders and talking about this all the time continues to be one of the important changes where both the product division and the HR group can support each other in being successful. So performance management, that's another example of a change that I think has happened in our organization in a really good way. So about a year and a half into our agile transformation, we could of course see that the whole setup with performance management did not fit so well with the agile ways of working and the agile ideas that we wanted to promote. So this is an example of a structure where you can say we tell people that the team is responsible for deliveries, but we still have an old traditional way of doing performance management with an annual cycle and personal goals and bonuses, etc. So you try in your team to work in one way and work in the agile way, but at the same time there's this structure that's kind of pulling you back to old ways of working. And so here we created a group of our people managers in the product division together with HR, and they together worked in a group to define a new process. So this is a change where you can say it was more controlled. There was input from both sides, and together they could work on what is the story we want to tell here, what is the change we want to make, how can we do it together, how can we sponsor this change so that it comes out as something that we are working on together. And so the change that actually happened was that we split everything up, and you can see here it also doesn't say performance management, it says continuous development. So this was also, as we heard before, the terminology that you use can actually guide you a lot. But here it's where the employee is, you look to the employee and look at how am I doing things and creating a development plan for the individual employee. And then the team is responsible for the performance or the delivery of things. And this happens on a quarterly basis together with the PI cycles. So this was just an example of another kind of change where the collaboration between the two groups was more coordinated, you can say, and where you really took advantage of doing the change together. So I think we are just wanted to mention the last thing then maybe before we run out of time, and lunch is coming up, I think. So do you? Yeah. So the learning and development, last year my colleague Ken Koops, he was up here and he talked about what we've done for learning and development. And you can say that in the SAFE roadmap that I showed before, one of the things that the roadmap talks a lot about is the training and the learning. And if you again think back to the ADCAR model, where knowledge and the training is the number three step, before we would have spent a lot of time on training, maybe upfront, maybe not talking a lot about why are we doing it and that people wanted to be part of it. But here we also made a coordinated effort to explain why are we doing the training, who is getting the training, and putting in place a lot of introduction so that when people heard now we are going to go agile, maybe felt uncertain, how am I going to do that? I don't know what it's all about. Then we actually had a setup that could support people in this journey towards working in a different way. And going forward, we have now created this learning organization, or a way that we can support people so that when we come back and say agile ways of working, we want to be learning continuously and developing, we actually have something that can support you so that you have different areas where you can get training in, and different behavioral competences also that we can focus on. So this is an example where you can say right from the outset we had a very good collaboration. We had a defined goal of where we wanted to go and also a structure in place to support us in moving in that direction. So just to conclude, as I said before, the key learnings, try to think about the change not towards only the organization, but also manage it towards the rest of the organization, that even though you might not be directly impacted by a change, it can have impact on you, and spend that time on getting people to come along. And the second thing, the structures, yes, you can do a lot of changes within the existing structures, but structures can actually also be blockers for mindset changes. And then finally, sharing all the stories. It's so important because that's how people understand what is going on and it gets them to move along. So that was it for me. Thank you.